Cool. So for the last couple of days, people have been talking about some of the amazing work that they have been doing. That's too difficult, so I'll be talking about somebody else's work, which is Tanmay's, who's somewhere around here, I hope. But that's okay, because Tanmay has done so many things that he's talking about another project of his right after this. What I want to talk about today is, so you have written a lot of Julia code. It's nice analytics or great mathematical stuff, but you eventually want to display it to a user who's over a web browser at some point, or want to send the data to some other legacy system, as the term is. So you want a way to sort of expose Julia code over the network that can be then accessed from, you know, external systems, either from other languages or across the network. And there are various ways of doing that today. What I will talk about is one such way, which I have found useful and that I actually use for some of my work. And it's pretty easy, it's pretty stable, it's not very high tech, but it uses a very stable set of Julia and the environment that you can depend on for production work. The primary code base for doing this is this package called juliawebapi.jl, which I think you'll have to clone, but it's a reasonably small package, maybe 100 lines of code all put together. So it's quite a simple thing. So the basic idea that that Julia Web API uses is to take the code that you write, or a function that you write, and expose it over a ZMQ interface. Why ZMQ? Because, ZMQ is pretty much like raw sockets, raw TCP sockets, but with a nicer API, with some amount of root control, some amount of queuing built in that you wouldn't get from a raw TCP socket. But in terms of practically how you use it, it's pretty much like you open up a socket on one process, and then you connect to it from another machine or another process, right? So let's look at some code right away and see how this works, right? So I have this code here, which is that visible? Back up. Yeah. So I have some code here, which is called sim.jl, which basically calculates the area under a normal curve using Monte Carlo, something like a Buffon's needle, but maybe a Buffon's point, right? So this is, if any of you saw Shashi's presentation yesterday on Azure, this was one of the sort of nice animations that it showed. So this is a code that there is the main point, entry point to this code is this function called simulate, which takes in the number of iterations that you want to run the simulation for, and it returns the estimate of the area under the normal curve. And so this is right up here, this is the function that is estimated, right? So that's the normal function. Very simple code, but this is easy to write in Julia, numeric code that you want to now call, that you want to now expose to the outside world, which is the world outside of Julia, right? So what do you do with this code? So the code to sort of expose it is pretty simple. It's basically these three, four lines of code over here, which is using Julia Web API, the package that I showed you earlier. It sets up logging a little bit, which is sort of irrelevant. What's happening? Okay. So it sets up logging, and then it includes the code that contains the actual logic that you want to run, the function that you want to run. And then it calls this process function, which is part of the Julia Web API, the Julia Web API package. And it sets up the endpoints for the function names that you provide over here. So there is this function simulate, and there's this function simulate time, which is the second function in my in my code. And it then gives the TCP endpoint where you want to host this. So this says that host this process on localhost on port 9999. You then give it a parameter saying bind equal to true, which means it'll start up a server that clients can listen on. Right? So that's really all that there is. I can show you the function once again. So the first function that you have is simulate. The second function that I have is simulate time, which is just, you know, returns the value and the time that it took to run that simulation, just to give you an example of two different things. Right? Now, all this is easy, but there are limitations because it is so easy. The main limitation is that the entire networking infrastructure that's built in doesn't do any type conversion. So everything on the network is a string, and so basically the entire thing works on string arguments. If you have non-string arguments like number here, which is, as I said, the number of times to run the simulation for, you just write a wrapper that takes a string and parses it into an integer. So this is one limitation of doing it this way, but I think it's my machine has gone for a toss. But I don't want to report anything to Microsoft. Oh. Right, back to, so this is the code that you set up the server, right? So this sets up a ZMQ server that just listens on the thing, on the network port. So let me go here. Can you see that? At the back again, is it visible? Maybe it's slightly larger. Here. Control, Command plus, right. So let me now run this, which was sim_server.jl. And export path. Yeah, so that's the code that I just showed you. I'm just running it, and it'll take a few seconds to get started up. And it'll sort of listen on port 9999. Now, if I then run a Julia process somewhere else, let's say I run Julia here, of course, and I over here say Julia Web API. Let's see if it has started up. Yes. So this was the process that I started, and you can see it says, registering endpoint simulate and simulate time, and then it says it is running on this. So it's running on TCP port 9999, right? Now I go back to my Julia server, to my Julia REPL, and I create here what is called an API invoker, right? And this gives it this creates an API invoker pointing to the same port. So now this has connected to the server that I had running. And then actually making that call is just calling something like this. So API call with the client location and the function name that you want and the arguments. And then you can have multiple arguments if you want. So now you have a Julia process that's running, which you can connect over the over TCP from some other machine or some other process and connect. The next thing that you can do is then wrap this ZMQ server with a REST server, right? So that you can then connect on the browser. So that code is equally simple. So this is the code that says sim-HTTP server that basically, again, creates an API invoker that points to the location of the server. And then you have this function called run REST, which will basically take this ZMQ server and expose it over HTTP on this port 8888, right? So let's run. So we are basically building the network up by layers, right? So let's see. So we have the path set. Now we say Julia sim. Uh, Julia sim HTTP server, right? Export Julia sim HTTP server. So this, we saw we had the ZMQ server. We are now building an HTTP server on top of that, which will talk to the ZMQ server over the network, and we will talk to the HTTP server over a browser. So this says listening on port 8888. Let's now go here and there. So this is an HTTP request. Maybe if I make it bigger at some point. So if you look here carefully, this is running on port 8888. I can't make that bigger, unfortunately. So if you look here, this is an HTTP server on 8888. And then I give it the function name and the parameter, right? And I get the result. Okay. Just one last quick thing before, if I don't mind. The next thing that I can do is I have this ZMQ server running. I can then run a Java client, which is a Java ZMQ client, which creates this, you know, create a ZMQ socket, and then send it a JSON object, and then you just, you know, send it that. And if I run that in another, over here, let's say Java, do I have Java here? So I say controller Java, so I say Java minus CP, JSON.jar, and then JeroMQ.jar, which is the JSON, which is the ZMQ client. And then I say sim, and sorry. And there, that then uses the Java ZMQ client and you know, gets the data. So this is Java connecting to Julia and getting the result, right? So that's it. Thank you for your time. Just one quick last thing to say. The reason to use ZMQ is that ZMQ has good, stable clients in all different languages. So if you create a ZMQ client in Julia, you can then call it from any other language, and Java being the example that I talked about here. Thank you.
We have time for one question, probably.
Yeah, while Tanmay sets up, if there's one question, quick one, so I can get it.
Have any questions for Abdul?
Okay, cool. Thank you.
Right, great. Thanks, all. Have another round of applause.
Thanks.